Hi friends, I welcome you for this discussion on part 2 of optical fibers, which is chapter 3 in module 3 of engineering physics curriculum with subject code 18PHY12/22. Myself, Dr. Mahesh Lohit KS, associate professor and head, department of physics, ATME College of Engineering, Mysuru, here to discuss the following topics on optical fibers in this session. First, we shall have a discussion on the modes of propagation, under which we study V number and the number of modes, and based on that we shall classify the optical fibers into three types. Next, we shall discuss about the attenuation of light in fiber and also the types of losses, that is fiber losses, which lead to the attenuation. Finally, we shall have a discussion on point to point communication using optical fibers. So, this is the plan of discussion today. The first topic of today's discussion is the modes of propagation. This modes of propagation is related to number of paths that are allowed for the propagation of light through the fiber. Let us discuss about the modes of propagation. Consider this diagram. We have different rays passing through the fiber. They are launched at the launching end, and after that they undergo multiple total internal reflections inside the fiber and they pass through. A ray has no thickness. So, therefore, it may appear as if any number of paths are allowed through the fiber, but it is not so. An optical fiber allows only certain number of paths or restricted number of paths for the propagation through it, and it is expressed in terms of the modes of propagation. Then what is the definition of modes of propagation? The maximum number of paths or rays supported by the fiber for the propagation of light through the fiber is called the modes of propagation. That is, the maximum number of rays or paths supported by the fiber for the propagation of light. The more the number of paths allowed for the propagation of light, higher will be the modes of propagation. How to estimate the modes of propagation or the number of paths allowed? It could be done with the help of a quantity called V number, which is also referred to as normalized frequency number. This normalized frequency number gives the or determines the number of modes supported by the fiber in an optical fiber for the propagation. It is given by the relation V is equal to pi d by lambda into numerical aperture. This particular term is numerical aperture. This we have discussed in the previous session. If the surrounding medium is air, we can replace this n naught square by 1. Therefore, the numerical aperture just becomes n1 square minus n2 square under square root. So, this is the formula for normalized frequency number or V number. Using this V number, the number of modes could be calculated, that is, number of modes supported by the fiber, n approximated to nearest integer V square by 2. For example, if it is 516.5, you can approximate it to the nearest integer. Okay, let us say it is 517 paths, because number of paths cannot be a fraction. Now, we shall study the classification of optical fibers. The optical fibers are classified into different types based on the modes of propagation and RI profile. We have already discussed about the modes of propagation. The modes of propagation is the maximum number of paths supported by the fiber for the propagation of light inside the fiber, or maximum number of rays that are supported by the fiber for propagation is called as modes of propagation, and it depends on the core size, the wavelength of the incident radiation and the numerical aperture, which in turn depends on the RI of core and cladding. RI profile, the classification of optical fibers is based on the RI profile. The RI profile is the variation of the refractive index with respect to the radial distance. So, it is a plot wherein the refractive index is plotted against the radial distance. Based on the modes of propagation and RI profile, optical fibers are classified into three types: single mode step index fiber, multi mode step index fiber, multi mode graded index fiber, or you can refer to it as step index single mode fiber, step index multi mode fiber, graded index multi mode fiber. These are the three types of optical fibers. Now, let us understand this single mode step index fiber. So, this is the description, and here we have a diagram. Let us make use of this diagram to understand the single mode step index fiber. This is the fiber, and the diameter of the fiber is 60 to 70 micrometer. So, the diameter of the single mode step index fiber is 60 to 70 microns, and the core is very, very small, and its diameter is 8 to 10 micrometer. It has a very small core size. Therefore, the light gathering ability is also very, very less. This is the RI profile. This RI profile is a plot of RI as a function of radial distance. This is the center of the fiber, and it is here, this is the center. Let us say we move radially towards the edge of the cladding on both sides. Okay. At each and every point, we measure the refractive index, and even on this side, we measure the refractive index at each and every point throughout core and cladding, and we plot a graph, we get this sort of a graph. RI remains constant throughout the core, okay, at a value n1. So, at the edge of the core, RI drops, RI of cladding is less, it drops to a value n2, but RI throughout the cladding remains constant. Even on this side, the RI remains constant throughout the cladding. So, here the refractive index is varying in steps. Inside the cladding, RI is n2, inside core, RI is n1, and you can see there is an abrupt change here, there is a step change. So, therefore, such a profile is called the step index profile, and the optical fiber is called step index fiber. Since the core size is very, very small, the amount of light it can gather is very, very less, and hence the modes of propagation is single mode. Since the number of paths allowed is very, very less, it is a single mode fiber, and usually laser source is used for the propagation, because if we use an LED, it is a diverging or converging beam. When there is a diverging beam, the total when they enter the optical fiber, the rays may not satisfy the condition for total interreflection. Therefore, a laser beam is used. Laser is a highly monochromatic, coherent, directional, intense beam. Since they are highly directional, the rays are parallel, the paths are parallel. Even if the fiber is bent, they strike the core cladding interface, but the total internal reflection condition is satisfied, and they propagate light rays, they propagate through the fiber. So, here the modes of propagation is single mode, because the core size is very, very small. Here we have mentioned one of the disadvantages of single mode step index fiber. The splicing of the fiber is difficult. What is splicing? We cannot manufacture an optical fiber which runs for hundreds of kilometers. So usually, say an optical fiber is fabricated which is of length say 1 kilometer or 2 kilometer. So then to carry the signal, two fibers have to be joined. So this is called as a splicing. The fibers are joined in such a way that the complete light from one fiber is transferred to the other fiber, and this is called as splicing. And the splicing process is very difficult. If there is a small change in alignment of the fibers, then the light is not effectively coupled. These optical fibers which are of single mode and step index type, they are used in submarine cables. It is just a mention of its application. The next type of optical fiber is multimode step index fiber or step index multimode fiber. This is the description and this is the diagram. We shall use the diagram to understand what is a multimode step index fiber. As mentioned here, the diameter of the fiber, you know, is from 100 to 250 micrometer. It's very large. And also the core diameter is 50 to 200 micrometer. Core size is also very, very large. And the RI profile is again step index here. What do we mean by step index? As we discussed, it's a plot of the RI with respect to the radial distance. So this is the center of the core. As you know, we consider points away from the core, at each and every point the RI remains N1, right? And at the core cladding interface, RI reduces to N2 and it remains N2 constant throughout the cladding. So throughout the cladding it remains N2. So, RI of cladding here, it is less, and the RI is varying in steps. So, this is a step index fiber, this is a step index fiber, step index. And also, since the core size is very, very large, it can gather large number of rays, okay, or large amount of light, and hence it is called as multimode. Many number of paths are available for the propagation of light. So, since the core size is large, we can even use LED as a source. See, LED generates a diverging beam of light, whereas laser, it generates an intense parallel beam of light which is coherent also. But in case of step index multimode fiber, we can use the LED also as a light source. The one application that we have mentioned is it is used in data links. The third type of optical fiber is multimode graded index fiber. As the name itself indicates, it is multimode, and hence the core diameter has to be very large. And graded index, the refractive index is not a step index variation, it is not an abrupt variation, it is a continuous variation. It is called graded index fiber. So, let us understand this graded index fiber with the help of this sketch. Similar to the multimode step index fiber, the diameter of the fiber is 100 to 250 micrometer and diameter of the core is 50 to 200 micrometer, and this is the RI profile. This is the center of the cross section, and it coincides with the axis here, the center of the axis. As we measure the refractive index of the material with respect to the radial distance, as we move away from the core, the RI of the core reduces continuously. You can see this continuous variation This is called as grading. There is a continuous variation, it is called grading. It is not abrupt variation similar to the step index fiber. And this is observed even on the other side, in all directions the same is observed, means Ri changes radially, means it reduces continuously along the radial distance. Means if I draw a circle here, if I draw a circle here, Ri on this path remains constant, Ri on this inner path also remain constant, whereas the Ri on the outer path is less than the Ri on the inner path, at all points of the inner path. So, such a variation is called the graded index variation. Ri is maximum at the center of the core, it decreases, and at the core cladding interface it reduces to a value N2, and from there on it remains constant throughout the cladding. Here it is the graded index variation, refractive index is graded. So, in case of multimode fibers, we can use either a laser or LED for the propagation of light. The light gathering ability is very, very large, as the core size is very, very large, and hence it is called as a multimode fiber. So, the number of paths allowed is more. But the way the waves light propagates is interesting here. You can see it takes a curved path here. It is because of the reason, when the ray of light is moving inside the fiber, it moves from one point to another point. This point closer to the axis is of higher Ri, and this point or the next adjacent point which is away from the optical fiber is of lower Ri. So, hence the ray of light is moving from the region of higher refractive index to lower refractive index, means it is moving from denser to rarer, it keeps on bending away from the normal, and hence the light takes a curved path like this. So, this is how the light propagates in case of a multimode graded index fiber. What is attenuation? The optical energy that is passing through the optical fiber gets progressively reduced, and it is called attenuation. If this is the fiber, some amount of energy is incident on the launching end, and all the energy is not received at the receiving end. A part of the energy is lost inside, because the energy gets progressively reduced, and this is called as attenuation. Therefore, the output power, the rate at which optical energy that is received from the receiving end, will always be less than the rate at which energy is incident on the launching end. Therefore, output power is less than the input power, and this is due to the losses in fiber, which we will discuss in the next topic. And this loss in optical energy is measured in terms of a quantity called attenuation coefficient. The attenuation, that is a progressive loss of optical energy, is measured in terms of a quantity called attenuation coefficient. This attenuation coefficient is given by formula. It is measured in decibel per kilometer. It is minus 10 by L. Here L is the length of the fiber in kilometer. Remember, if it is 500 meter, we need to convert this into kilometer, 0.5. Okay. So, this is log to base 10 P out by P in, so many decibel per kilometer. Therefore, this attenuation coefficient is defined as the ratio of the output power to the input power of the optical fiber of length L for a given wavelength of light. Even we need to mention the wavelength of light lambda. So, this attenuation depends on wavelength, because the fiber losses depend on the wavelength. So, therefore, attenuation coefficient is defined as the ratio of the optical power output to the optical power input for a fiber of length L and for a given wavelength of light. So, this is about the attenuation. Now attenuation is due to fiber losses. There are various fiber losses, and we discuss here the three types of fiber losses. The three types of fiber losses are the absorption losses due to absorption, then scattering losses due to Rayleigh scattering. You know that the blue color of the sky is due to scattering, and the red color or orange color of the horizon during the sunrise or sunset is also due to Rayleigh scattering. Then finally, we shall also study the geometric effects, which is also referred to as radiation losses. We shall understand each one in detail. The first type of loss is called absorption loss, and the absorption loss in optical fiber is due to the absorption of the input optical power, optical signal, by the material of the fiber. So let us say fiber is made of glass or some other material, plastic say, and that material absorbs light. And there are two ways in which absorption occurs. One is called intrinsic absorption and the other is called extrinsic absorption. So the loss of signal power occurs due to the absorption of photons associated with the signal, and these photons are absorbed by the material of the fiber, and material of the fiber also has impurities. So if the photons are absorbed by the pure material of the glass of the fiber, that is called as intrinsic absorption. When the light is absorbed by the impurities that are present in the glass or the material of the fiber, then such a loss is referred to as extrinsic loss. And this extrinsic loss is due to hydroxyl ions, that is OH minus, and also due to the transition metal ions that are present, that is ferrous ions, chromium, cobalt and copper, nickel, etc. These transition metal ions, they also absorb energy, and this is referred to as absorption loss. As we discussed, the absorption loss is due to intrinsic and extrinsic losses. So the Rayleigh scattering, the scattering loss. So in case of an optical fiber, even though we assume that the density of the fiber or RI of the fiber remains constant, during the drawing process, the density may not remain same. There may be small regions where the density is slightly different, not at all places, but there are some there may be some locations inside the fiber where the densities are, I mean to say, the refractive index is slightly different, and the light undergoes scattering from such centers. So light traveling through the core can get scattered by impurities or small, it can get scattered by impurities and also small regions of sudden change in refractive index. There will be a change in refractive index because of the change in density, and which results in the loss of photons as the photons escape through the fiber, you know, it escape to the surrounding. So in case of Rayleigh scattering, the scattering is inversely proportional to the wavelength. So let us understand this. So let us say we have a particle here, either it's an impurity atom or it's a region inside the optical fiber where the density is different. This is the incident photon with the wavelength lambda, and it undergoes a scattering. If there is no particle here or this region, this light would have taken the straight path, and there is a deviation here, and this angle is called the angle of scattering. Okay? And this angle depends on the wavelength. Okay? Therefore, this Rayleigh scattering alpha varies as inversely as the fourth power of wavelength. Higher the wavelength, okay, smaller will be the scattering. Means for red, the scattering will be very, very less. For blue, scattering will be more. So, such a scattering is called the Rayleigh scattering. See, similarly, we can have an example. Let us say this is the earth here, and let us say we are standing here, and the sun is here. This is the horizon. When we are watching the sun in the morning, this is the horizon. Light rays are coming, and due to the particles in the atmosphere, they undergo scattering. Red and orange, they undergo least scattering, otherwise they would have traveled straight. For blue rays, they get scattered most. So, we receive maximum number of red and orange rays, therefore, the horizon appears orange. So, this is due to Rayleigh scattering. So, Rayleigh scattering is responsible for the maximum losses in the optical fiber, because it is very difficult to control the RI, the uniformity in the density. Techniques have evolved nowadays to even control that in to better extent. So, this is a picture or image where you can understand the scattering loss. You can see here, it is incident, light is incident, and the scattering takes place. The photons may get scattered in various directions due to the compositional fluctuation. Composition fluctuation means the variation in RI. So, how to explain this? See, when you are eating something, you may get a small particle, let us say salt, small particle of salt. So, means salt is not uniformly distributed throughout that eatable. So, such a thing may happen even in case of optical fiber. So, do not consider that, I am just giving an example, and it is just an analogy, that is all. So, like that, even in case of optical fibers, there are regions where the there is a change, slight variation in the RI in some regions. The last type of fiber loss is called radiation loss, which is also referred to as geometric loss. And radiation, therefore, optical energy takes place due to this geometric effects. What are the geometric effects? See, this optical fiber has to be drawn. Let us say we take a glass and we make a fiber out of it. It has to be drawn, it has to be heated and pulled so that we get a small strand of it. So, the technique is very evolved, and it has to be done with a lot of precision, and it is done. Even though it is done with high precision, there may be some variations called microscopic bends and macroscopic bends. So, macroscopic bends are due to the handling, whereas microscopic bends are generated during the process of drawing the fiber. These are the defects that are present inside the fiber. So, what is the meaning of this microscopic bend? Let me draw the cross section. Now, let us say this is the launching end of the fiber. I write it as a straight line because this is the side view. A circle appears like a straight line. So, just that, we are writing it in two dimension. This is the optical fiber and this is the core, and you can just see here, it is not a smooth surface. The interface between the core and cladding, this is clad and this is core. The interface, the region of contact between core and clad, is not a smooth surface, very smooth surface. There are variations on this, like this. While drawing, there will be variations. So, due to these variations, let us say there is a variation here somewhere inside. We have magnified this region. We have magnified this region. Now, the ray of light passing through it strikes the region, but here the condition for total internal reflection is not satisfied, and hence the ray, it escapes from the fiber, it just undergoes refraction. So, this particular ray is lost, and the irregularities are these, the radius of this is smaller than the radius of the core, and such bends are called microscopic bends. And the reason for these bends are the drying process, coating, cabling and insulation process, etc. So these microscopic bends, they couple light between various guided modes of the fiber, and the light leaks through the fiber, which we just discussed. And in addition to that, there may be macroscopic bends. What are macroscopic bends? Macroscopic bends have radii more than the core diameter. For example, we have an optical fiber, say, and this optical fiber is bent like this. So this is while handling. So this is the other end of the optical fiber. This is the launching end, this is the receiving end. Now, if we draw the core cladding interface here, this is the core. When light is passing through it, it strikes the core cladding interface here, and the condition for total internal reflection is not satisfied, and hence it escapes. So we cannot bend the optical fiber too sharply. If we do that, due to this geometry, the light escapes from the fiber, and hence there is a loss in the optical energy. So since light is radiated from the fiber, it is radiated out, it escapes, and such a loss is called radiation loss, which is also referred to as geometric loss. In both the cases, light escapes because the total internal reflection condition is not satisfied. You can observe here. So these are the microscopic bends here, and this is the macroscopic bend. Okay, this is while handling the fiber, and this is during the manufacture. So light rays escape. Even here there is a bend, and since the total internal condition, internal reflection condition is not satisfied, it escapes from the fiber. So this is about the fiber losses. We understood the attenuation, and attenuation is due to the fiber losses, and there are various losses. Intrinsic absorption, extrinsic absorption, scattering, microscopic bending, loss due to microscopic bends and macroscopic bends. The last topic of this particular module 3, and also the last topic of this optical fiber, that is chapter 3, is point to point communication using optical fiber. What do we mean by point to point communication? See, let us understand this with an example. There is a sender of information and there is a receiver. For example, I am making a phone call to my friend. I am the source and my friend is the receiver. Now, how do I send information? Nowadays, we know that we use mobiles, and it may be the landline also. Nowadays, it is very rare to find the landlines. You know, most of us, we use only mobile phones. When I speak in front of the mic that is present in the mobile phone, there will be a mic. That mic is called as a transducer, and this transducer converts the mechanical energy, that is sound energy, into the electrical energy. So here we have the microphone of the sender. So there is a sender here, and he uses the microphone, and it converts the sound waves, which are nothing but mechanical waves, into the electrical signals. And those electrical signals are weak, so they are amplified using an amplifier, and we get an electrical analog of the signal. The way the sound varies, the in the same way electrical signal also varies, but its amplitude or its magnitude will be more in case of electrical signal due to the amplification. And this signal is digitized using a coder. Digitization means, let us say, it is just an example. We have a signal or a pulse of this height. Let us say it is 10 volt. Now, if I pass it through the optical fiber, as we know, the energy is lost. At the output, the voltage may vary, and it may become less, and it may be V1, which is less than V2. So, if this is 10 volt, and it may be, let us say, 5 volt, means the signal has been modified at the output. So, in order to avoid this, these pulses or these voltage variations are converted into a series of digital waves based on some criteria, and this conversion takes place in this coder, which is also called as a digitizer. This is also called as a digitizer. Then coded signal, electrical signal, is fed to an optical transmitter, and this optical transmitter is a electronic circuitry which controls either a laser or a laser diode or a LED. So, this digital signal, as it passes through that LED or the laser diode, the optical energy, the intensity of light generated by this particular optical source varies in accordance with the signal that is fed to the optical transmitter. Now, this information is taken through this optical fiber all along the length till here, it reaches this place, and here there is a receiver part, and it is called as a photo detector or optical receiver. The light from the optical fiber at the receiving end, this is the launching end where the light is launched, and this is the receiving end, it is received by, say, photodiode. Now, the conduction of the photodiode depends on the amount of light or the intensity of light incident, and hence the signal or the amount of current induced in this optical photodiode depends on the amount of light incident on this photodiode. So, here this photodiode detects light and it conducts, the conduction or the current through it depends on the intensity of light, and here the optical signal is converted into the electrical signal. And this electrical signal has to be decoded, because either earlier we had coded this. So, this will be decoded, and the replica of the same old signal, that is the initial signal which was fed to the coder, is obtained here. And as this signal is obtained from the photo detector, it may be very weak, and it is fed to an amplifier, and an electrical analog, it is nothing but an amplifier, and it is amplified, and later it is fed to a loudspeaker. A loudspeaker is again a transducer which converts electrical energy into mechanical energy or sound waves. So, here we have the receiver. The receiver listens to this sender, okay, through the earpiece. So, in between, when I speak through the mobile phone, speak over the mobile phone, the energy is transmitted in the form of electromagnetic radiation. It reaches the nearest tower, this is a wireless transmission, and from that tower, the destination tower where the receiver is located, it passes through the optical fiber, and all these processes occur in the tower, near the tower, and then the energy is taken through the optical fiber, and at the receiving tower these processes are achieved, and finally the communication takes place, and such a communication is point to point communication, and it is made possible with the help of the optical fibers. So, this is the description which I have already given. So, transducer, mic is used, converted into an optical electrical signal, coder, it is input to the coder, it digitizes the signal, then it is fed to the optical transmitter converts the electrical signal into optical signal, it passes through the optical fiber, it received by the optical receiver at the receiving end. The optical receiver is nothing but, let us say, a photodiode, and it converts the signal into that is optical signal into electrical signal. It is fed to decoder, it is where the information is decoded and it is amplified, and finally it is fed to the speaker. Now, what are the advantages and disadvantages of this fiber communication, that is point to point fiber communication, over the normal mode of communication, which is, let us say, using copper cables? So, first thing is there will be lot of energy savings, and the number of channels that are allowed are very good. Let us understand this in detail. Signals are, you know, protected from lightning and sparking. If we have a copper cable, whenever there is a lightning or sparking, there will be an interruption. Due to the interaction, in this copper cable, there will be a modification, slight modification in the signal. There may be a distortion in the output. So, therefore, these copper cables are not preferred, and the optical fibers are preferred over. So, the sparking or lightning, they do not affect the optical fiber. And these optical fibers, they are very compact when compared to, you know, copper cables and other cables, and they can transmit any amount of large amount of information both in analog and digital form. You know the analog form and you know the digital form now. The raw material for this optical fiber is abundant, that is nothing but silicon. It is very abundant, you know, it is glass. We make glass out of silica sand. And if we compare the cost effectiveness, the optical fiber is cost effective when compared to the copper cable. So, you may wonder, the copper cable costs less, whereas the optical fiber costs more. Then how come, you know, this is better than copper cable? See, let us say we have an optical fiber. This optical fiber, let us say it is of 1 meter. It costs say 200 rupees, but it allows, let us say, 500 channels. Whereas copper cable, 1 meter, it costs 100 rupees, it allows only 200 channels. Now, we shall calculate a quantity called cost per meter per channel. So, in case of optical fiber, cost is 200, per meter is 1 meter, there are 500 channels. So, it is 2 by 5, 2 by 5 is 0.4. Okay. So, whereas for copper, it is 100 divided by 1 into 200, this is 0.5, and these values are cost per meter per channel. So, cost per meter per channel. This is how the optical fibers are cost effective. So, low cost per meter per channel. There is no energy radiation from the fiber. See, in case of a copper cable, when they carry signal, a magnetic field is generated, and that magnetic field varies in accordance with the current, variation of current, and also there may be a radiation of energy. So, in case of optical fibers, no energy is radiated because of the reason it is the light that passes through the optical fiber, core of the optical fiber, in terms of total internal reflection. So, there is no radiation of energy from the fiber, and no sparks are generated because electrical energy is not involved when the signal passes through the optical fiber. So, therefore, no sparks are generated. In spite of all these advantages, this optical fiber also has disadvantages. So, let us understand the disadvantages of this fiber communication. See, optical connectors are very costly. So, as I said, we have to use optical connectors to effectively transfer the light from one optical fiber to another optical fiber after splicing. So, these are very costly. Whereas, in case of copper, what they do? If there is a, you know, a break in the cable, they remove the insulation, they take out the copper the studs, and they twist them together, that is all. So, that ends the story there. But the signal quality won't be good there. In case of optical fibers, opto connectors are used. The maintenance cost is very high. See, you need to check the cables regularly. So, if an optical coupler fails, or if there is some issue, or if there is a breakage in the, or if the, you know, breakage in the cable or the fiber, if the fiber cable is bent too sharply, you don't get the signal. So, the maintenance cost in maintenance has to be very regular, and the cost will also be more, and we cannot bend the fiber too sharply. If it is bent, total internal condition, internal reflection condition is lost, and hence the energy is lost. There is one more important disadvantage here. This disadvantage is of concern. These optical fibers, they may undergo structural changes with respect to temperature. When there is a temperature, they may undergo structural changes, and these fibers are laid, you know, below the surface of the earth. But still, when there is a temperature variation, there may be a change in the structure, and even when there is a mechanical stress, there may be a change in the structure. Now, at the end of the session, we shall have MCQs just for the sake of knowing what we have understood. The first question is, modes of propagation of an optical fiber depends on. So, here we have four options. Modes of propagation depends on numerical aperture, we need to find out, then core size, then wavelength of the incident light, all the above. So, pick your choice, and later we shall discuss which is the correct option. Yes, please. Okay, friends, as we have discussed, numerical aperture determines the light gathering ability. Therefore, modes of propagation, number of paths allowed, depends on the numerical aperture, and this numerical aperture depends on the refractive indices of core and cladding. And obviously, the core size is a decider for these modes of propagation. It plays a decisive role. So, more the core size, more the light that propagates, and hence higher the modes of propagation. And in V number, we have studied that it depends inversely on the wavelength. Higher the wavelength, the smaller will be the V number, and smaller will be the modes of propagation. So, therefore, the correct option is the last one, all the above. So, all the above are correct. So, modes of propagation depends on all the three. The second multiple choice question is, which of the following is not a type of fiber loss? So, there are four options here: absorption loss, that is the first one, second one scattering, third one reflection, and fourth one radiation. Please pick the choice, pick a choice. Yes, friends. So, as per the discussion held, we know about this absorption loss, which is due to absorption, scattering loss by the regions which have slightly different RI, then reflection, we have no idea, we have not studied. Radiation, yes, of course, the light is radiated out of the fiber due to the microscopic and macroscopic bends, and hence this reflection is an incorrect type. So, it is not a type of optical fiber loss, and hence the option 3 is the correct answer. So, we have come to the end of the today's session, and with this we complete the whole theory part of this particular module, and in the next two lectures we shall deal with the numerical problems, that is lecture 9 and lecture 10. So, here I have an information for you. We have Dr. Narinder Singh Kapani, who is an Indian born scientist, and he is called as the father of fiber optics. It is because of him you see images on the internet. So, how the propagation of light takes place and how the signals have to be modulated, all those things, you know, are researched by Dr. Narendra Singh Kapani. Let us salute him. With this, we come to the end of this session. I wish you all the best. Have a great day. We shall close the session. Thank you very much.